Thank you, Frank. Good morning, everybody. My name's Scott. I'm the pastor here at Fifth Reformed Church. If you are a guest here today, I'm just really glad that you're here, but you also need to know that you're catching the caboose of the train that's been going by over the last essentially 2 months. We've been in a preaching series called Jesus Reaching, and it all has stemmed from this image that we see on the screen depicting that moment when Peter got out of the boat, walked on the water with Jesus, took his eyes off Jesus like we sometimes do, and he began to sink into the water. And Jesus, filled with mercy and compassion, reached out, grabbed Peter, and pulled him back up. And we've been remembering all the different times and ways and places that Jesus has been reaching into the lives of people in the Gospels. We remember Jesus reaching into the life of the paralytic. Remember, they lowered him through the roof in front of Jesus, and Jesus reached in with a healing word and a word of grace and forgiveness. We remember Jesus reaching out to the outcasts. In particular, that we looked at the story of Zacchaeus, the tax collector. We remember Jesus reaching out to children. The disciples said, "Hey, get those kids out of here." And Jesus said, "Whoa, whoa, whoa. Bring those kids here. I want to place my hand on them and bless them." We remember Jesus reaching out to outsiders in his conversation in John 4 with the Samaritan woman who had had multiple husbands over the course of her life and a lot of brokenness there, and Jesus was reaching out to her. Jesus was reaching out to the hopeless with the death of Lazarus and Mary and Martha, thinking, this is a done deal and this is a dark day for us. And Jesus says, "Time out. I'm the resurrection and the life," and brought a word of hope and even the presence of hope, calling Lazarus out of the grave. And then a couple weeks ago, Darren preached while I was away, preaching on Jesus reaching the stuck, the guy who was next to the pool at Bethesda. And whenever the water was stirred, he'd been there for years, and he thought, "I'm stuck here because I can never get to that water." And Jesus called him out of that stuckness. And then Jesus reaching the worried, the royal official who came and said, "Will you come back to my home 25 miles away and heal my son?" And Jesus spoke a word of blessing and a word of healing into that situation. And you might recall, if I could just take a second here, you might recall that last week when we did Jesus Reaching the Worried, I asked you all to submit a post-it note that we had put on the inside of the bulletin, and we placed them in this bowl here. And my discernment was that that was a really good thing for us to do, because you were writing something that was vibrating, pulsating with worry for you on there. And to be able to do what it says in the scriptures, to cast your cares, literally to cast your cares upon the Lord, and then to acknowledge that this is the community of faith that we are. And I placed my hand on that bowl and we prayed for those things. Somebody wrote me an email this last week and said, "I think we should do that on a more regular basis." And I thought, what a good and healthy thing to do, to acknowledge the worries that we have and to invite people to bring them. So you can anticipate seeing this bowl as a part of our worship experience, the Worry Bowl. Maybe, I don't know if it's that name's going to stick, but we're going to have that kind of a presence here in what we do at Fifth. Today we're talking about Jesus reaching the self-centered. And on our way to discussing this, I wanted to highlight for you a coupon that I came across. This was for a free gallon of blinker fluid at AutoZone. And if you're sitting there thinking, "What's this about?" Let me just tell you, there is no such thing as blinker fluid. It sounds like the stuff you squirt on your windshield. But people all across the country, AutoZone was complicit in this. People all across the country were taking this spoof coupon and driving their teenage sons and daughters to AutoZone and sending them in there with the coupon to get their free gallon of blinker fluid. And as you know, blinkers don't need fluid. And if you want to have a good laugh this afternoon, go home and look up on YouTube blinker fluid. There's this video clip. It just takes just a minute or two to watch it. This high school girl, she was sent into AutoZone. She comes out of there, man, she's laughing, but she's mad. And her dad embarrassed her, gave her a coupon, and she went in there, and she said, they were all laughing at me. They said, there is no such thing as blinker fluid. And she said, but our blinkers aren't working right. And the guy said, well, then maybe you need a new light bulb. And thanks, Brett. I'll take that under advisement. Maybe you need a new light bulb. There is no such thing as blinker fluid. And she said, yes, there is. I have a coupon for it. And I was prompted to have a little fun with Mrs. Van Arendonk, my wife. I texted her this last week, and I said, how's the fluid level on our blinker fluid in your car? And she wrote back, and she said, it's fine. The guy who changes the oil, he takes care of that every time we come through there. And I almost sent her the coupon and said, I want you to stop at AutoZone and get a gallon of blinker fluid if you'd be willing. I think it's okay for parents to do that to their high school kids, but I'm not so sure that this is safe for spouses. I would have been in some serious hot water had I carried that spoof even further. I wish you could have been here in the first service, because I never really pulled the curtain back on the whole deal, and she found out during first service that that whole conversation was a bit of a spoof. Anyway, sometimes in life, it feels like we're sent on errands for blinker fluid, and we're chasing after something that doesn't exist, or at least it doesn't promise. It doesn't deliver on what is promised. Maybe you've been in a conversation where somebody introduces a new line of thought or questioning in the conversation, and another person says, wait a minute, that's a red herring. You know what a red herring is? It's something you introduce to a conversation that takes you away from the original subject and ends up being a dead end. There's nothing there at the end of it. And the literal meaning where that came from, the whole concept of a red herring, when there's a group of beagles chasing a rabbit, somebody will walk across the rabbit trail dragging a piece of fish, and for a while it will be mingled with the rabbit, and then the beagles come to think that that is the trail, and then the trail goes off away from the rabbit, and the beagles end up getting nothing. That's what the whole thing of a red herring is. And I share all of this imagery about an errand for blinker fluid or a red herring, because there's a question that sometimes gets asked that feels like we're sort of in this territory with red herring and blinker fluid, and that is, what is the definition of a Christian? And I just want to acknowledge with you, I think this is a very important question to give our best thought and faithfulness to, and to try to do what we can to discern what the Bible says. But I just want to acknowledge that there is a huge variety of opinions and responses to that question. I mean, any person who goes to the Yellow Pages, to the church section, and looks at all the different brand names of churches that we've got here right in Muskegon County, you're going to get a lot of different answers to this question just based on that. And that's to say nothing of what non-church people think about Christians. Because Dave Kinnaman, in his book Unchristian, he has discovered through sociological studies and surveys and such that much of an unbelieving public or a non-church-going public, they have opinions about Christians that Christians are hypocritical, judgmental, self-righteous people who think they know everything and who think they know who's going to heaven and who's going to hell. I mean, those are the kinds of things that non-church or non-believing people believe about Christians. And so I'm just telling you that when we start asking this question, what is the definition of a Christian? This fly has been tormenting me. It occurred to me that he might be drawn to the light glaring off of my head. Where was I? We're asking this question, what is the definition of a Christian? And Kinnaman says that all those people think that about us. And maybe a better question for us to ask is this one right here. What is a disciple or a follower of Jesus? And the reason I think this is a better question is because if we're looking to the scriptures to be our guide here, there's only three places where the word Christian is mentioned in the New Testament. And Jesus never uses the word. The word first turns up when they were describing the people who were associated with the early church in Antioch. And the word was used to describe those who were a part of the Jesus movement. And it was kind of a derogatory, derisive term. And I don't know that Jesus spends a lot of time defining Christian. The Bible and Jesus do spend a lot of time talking about what it means to be a disciple, what it means to be a follower. And in particular, this morning, we're looking at a passage in which Jesus lifts up one of the waving red flags about what identifies a person as a disciple of Jesus. So when we turn to the passage today in John 13, I want you to put your best ears on and listen for what is that one variable that identifies a person as a disciple of Jesus. Listen to this in John 13. It was just before the Passover festival. Jesus knew that the hour had come for him to leave this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. I love that phrase. He loved them to the end. Verse 2, the evening meal was in progress, and the devil had already prompted Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot, to betray Jesus. Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power, and that he had come from God and was returning to God. So he got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing, and wrapped a towel around his waist. Now, let me just put some words of description around what's happening here. When somebody was holding a dinner party at their house, there would be the lowest servant on the totem pole whose job it was to wash the guests' feet. And people in that day and age wore sandals. So they were either washing dust from the road or mud from the road. It was one or the other, but there was always going to be something that needed to be washed, and that task always fell to that lowest person on the totem pole. And so Jesus is in a room full of self-centered people because everyone notices, oh no, nobody made arrangements to have the servant kid here to wash the feet, but it's not going to be me. I mean, that was the body language, what people were, how they were responding to what was going on in this situation. And Jesus sees the problem and he gets active about it. He starts to don the servant's uniform, right? Verse 5, after that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet, drying them with the towel that was wrapped around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, Lord, are you going to wash my feet? Jesus replied, you did not realize now what I am doing, but later you will understand. No, said Peter, you shall never wash my feet. Jesus answered, unless I wash you, you have no part with me. Then, Lord, Simon Peter replied, not just my feet, but my hands and my head as well. Jesus answered, those who have had a bath need only to wash their feet. Their whole body is clean, and you are clean, though not every one of you. For he knew who was going to betray him, and that was why he said not everyone was clean. When he had finished washing their feet, he put on his clothes and returned to his place. Do you understand what I have done for you? He asked them. You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I have set you an example that you should do as I have done for you. I hope you start to sense, you're going to see that word do turn up in a minute. Jesus is casting a vision, not for one of his followers with regard to a certain belief system or a certain style of worship, but about a way of living, a way of doing, right? Very truly, I tell you, no servant is greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them, Jesus said. And then later, a few verses later. A new command I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. Now, what would God want us to see about this story? First of all, we need to see that Jesus was on a mission of love. This was the heartbeat of why Jesus came. And you see this in verse 1. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. So often our misguided notion of love does not have us following through on our commitments. We love while it's convenient. But when it ceases to be convenient, well, then I'm out of here. I'm going to move on. And Jesus doesn't have that mode of being at all. He loved them to the end. And really, this needs some further explaining of what's going on here in this passage. There are three different Greek words for love: eros, philia, and agape. The word eros is the word from which we get the word erotic. And don't think in sexual terms so much as finding somebody or something attractive or desirable. That's eros love. That can apply to a lot of different things, not just person relationships, but food or life experiences and that kind of thing. And then there's philia, which is kind of brotherly affection. You know, Philadelphia, the city of brotherly love, right? Having a brotherly kind of affection for somebody else. When I think of a couple people who are prominent in my life that would be characterized by that kind of brotherly affection, love, Greg Vandermeer, the fellow I worked with at Fairhaven Church, I love that guy like a brother. My hunting partner, Larry Bile from the New Era Church, I've known this guy. He is like a brother. My kids call him Uncle Larry, and they mean it, and there's no a misunderstanding about who it is we're talking about when we talk about Uncle Larry. There is that brotherly kind of affection there. But then there's this last kind of love, agape love. And this kind of love is the love that expresses itself through self-sacrifice. We love even though somebody might disappoint us. We love even though it might cost us greatly. And we love with a willingness to see something through. That's what those words were in verse 1. He loved them to the end without regard to the cost that this would bring to himself. I think God would want us to see this about the kind of love that is being exhibited here and the kind of love that Jesus has in mind. Secondly, Jesus was reminding them of what they had already been taught. Later in the verses that we read, Jesus says, a new command I give you. And we might want to say, time out, a new command? Wait a minute. This commandment to love is something that's very old, Leviticus 19. Love your neighbor as yourself. I mean, this is hundreds and hundreds of years before the time of Jesus that we're seeing this commandment to love. Jesus remembers this in his own teaching. In the words of the great commandment, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Love your neighbor as yourself. This is not necessarily a new command, at least so far in this discussion. And then this whole matter of becoming a servant. Jesus, before this whole deal, had called his disciples to a life of servanthood. Whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant. And whoever wants to be first must be your slave. There has to be this willingness to serve. What is new about this commandment is that Jesus is saying, love as I have loved you. I now become the means of interpreting what that love looks like. And so this is what Jesus is doing. Jesus is clarifying this commandment to love. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. This is the piece that makes this new, right? Jesus is showing them what that love looks like. Now, some of you might recall that maybe 5-6 weeks ago, I quoted something that Andy Stanley said that really stuck with me. I don't know if he originally said this, but he's the one I heard it from. And that is that if you want to know what Jesus meant by what Jesus said, look at what Jesus does. If you want to know what Jesus meant by what he said, look at what Jesus does. And in this situation, what does Jesus do? He leaves his place of prominence because he was kind of the kingpin of the dinner party, and he goes and takes the very lowest role in the equation. And this whole event was a kind of precursor for the way that Jesus would lay down his life on the cross. Because he's reminding them, as I have loved you, so you should love one another. I am your teacher, I'm your rabbi. You are to follow my example. My example is to take up that lowliest role, even to the point of laying down my life on a cross. That's what the larger message here is that Jesus is bringing, clarifying this message of love. And then fourthly, Jesus was adding to the urgency of the commandment of love. And this one really gets my attention, where he says this: by this everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. Jesus does not say, by your theological system of understanding who God is and what the Bible says, people will know that you are my disciples. He does not say, by your worship style and the songs that you sing, people will know that you are my disciples. He does not say, by the clothes that you wear, people will know that you are my disciples. There's one thing that Jesus identifies: if you love one another, by this everyone will know that you are my disciples. If you love one another. So what is a faithful response to this? And I would encourage us to think again in terms of I need to pay attention to Jesus' agape love for me. When I do know and celebrate that Jesus died for the world, but when I narrow it down to just me, when Jesus left his throne and took up human flesh, when he demonstrated patience with his disciples, man, that one really gets my attention. Jesus was patient with me. He left his throne in heaven and came to be my teacher, and he has been so patient with me. And then for him to lay down his life so that I could be forgiven and live with the promise of heaven, Jesus did all of this for me. He did that for you as well. And it is an incredibly spiritually healthy thing to do, to acknowledge what Jesus has done for us. It puts us in a completely different posture in so many levels. Secondly, I need to give thanks for those who took the role of servant on my behalf. You know, over the course of my years, there were my parents, Sunday school teachers, youth group sponsors, neighbors, mentors, all who sowed seeds of God's grace in my life. And they did this at great cost to themselves. And if there's one person that I pick out who maybe suffered more than most with all of that, it would be my mother. And I just wonder, who of you can raise your hand and look back on your own spiritual pilgrimage and be aware of those who self-sacrificed in order for you to become a child of God? Would you raise your hand if you can think back on somebody who self-sacrificed for you? A lot of hands going up around here. That is something that you and I need to be grateful for, because the grace of Jesus comes to us often through the sacrifices of somebody else. Not just Jesus. Certainly through Jesus, but not just him. Thirdly, I need to come to clarity on my basin and towel. Jesus grabbed his basin and his towel, and these became the tools of demonstrating the kind of love that he wanted replicated in the lives of his disciples. And I would just encourage you to think about Your basin and towel may be unique to you and may be different from the person sitting next to you, but you have them. You have a basin and a towel. You have something at your disposal in your time and your talent and your treasure and your life and experience. You have a basin and a towel, and these are tools with which you can bless somebody else, living and loving self-sacrificially. I can't tell you what that is. I may have some ideas, but I think you need to ask God to show you what your basin and towel are so that you can be responsible in using them to share his love. And then lastly, step into that role that nobody else wants. Jesus left his place of prominence and took the very lowest form of the servant. What does that look like in your marriage? What does that look like in your home? What does that look like in your classroom at school? What does it look like maybe in your place of work or in your neighborhood or in your extended family? In what ways do people see the servant's uniform on you as you are following Jesus' example of stepping into that role that nobody else wants? I wanted to end this morning by reminding you that this teaching about loving as Jesus loved, being willing to take the role of a servant, is not just front and center in Jesus' teaching about what it means to be a disciple or a follower. But it's also present in Paul's teaching. And so I wanted to remind you what it says in Philippians 2. The way that I didn't do the formatting of this passage in the way that it appears in your Bible. These words were probably sung by the early church. So these are the words of a song. But the text is so powerful. Your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant. Is this not what Jesus did when he washed the disciples' feet? This is the mandate, the call, the invitation on our lives to love as Jesus loved. And so I paraphrase this. As followers of Jesus, my attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus. And then I thought, wait. Jesus is not really concerned about what we think about all of this. He actually doesn't even care about our attitude about all of this. Jesus cares more about what we're going to do about all of this, right? Because we can have all our beliefs and all of our attitudes, but if it never reaches the point of translating into actions, then we've missed the boat. Because Jesus, in this passage, is all about doing, right? Doing the loving thing. So I want to invite us to say these words, not just about our attitude, but then, come on. As a follower of Jesus, the example of my life should be, okay? We're paraphrasing, putting legs on this matter of following the example of Jesus. And I think that there's probably an opportunity for you to love somebody or to take the role of a servant that is floating around in your mind right now, that the Spirit of God has brought to you because of these words that have been shared here today. And let's apply Scripture to that and be blessed by what God has to say. So let's say these words together. As a follower of Jesus, the example of my life should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant. Let's pray. Father, thank you for speaking to us. Thank you, Jesus, for reaching into our lives and pulling us out of our self-centeredness. Thank you, Jesus, for giving us a vision of love. Love as the identifying feature of what it means to be a follower of yours. Thank you, Jesus, for calling us out of this errand of blinker fluid or chasing a red heron, which leads to nothing when we think it's all about a belief system or our attitudes. Thank you for calling us to a life, to living this way. Thank you for showing us what it's like to lay down your life. May we follow your example and live likewise. Hear us, for we pray in your name. Amen.